Let's return to what we're really here for, which is Tom's new album. No. We are in Tom's studio, and Tom is engineering for fans of Friends of Dan and Olivia. Anytime I say joining me in the studio, it means I'm in Los Angeles at Tom's place.
Yeah, and I see a couple of basses on stands here, so.
He's a fine bass player. Keep him in mind. You're on notice, Pat Kilbride. Well, you have a track called Anyone that has a really nice mood and ambiance. Is that an electric sitar or is it a keyboard simulation?
No, it's an electric sitar. It's what they used to call electric sitar in the 60s, but was mainly a choral guitar. It was a brand name thing where they basically have two bridges, and one bridge on the guitar is supporting the strings like a normal guitar bridge, and the other one is just slightly touching it, and it gives you that sitar kind of buzz.
Yeah. Okay, I think of two things. I think of Denny Dia's solo on Do It Again.
Absolutely,
and
yeah.
And then I think of Pat Metheny with his sitar instrument, you know, in terms of instrumentation. All that really matters is, I knew it was electric and not a regular acoustic sitar, but I also know with keyboards these days, I figured it was Justin playing it.
Yes, it was Justin, and I think he had to temporarily acquire one of those guitars to play that track. You know, the other thing that that sound makes me think of is the stylistics,
because
they used it on a bunch of tracks. I think it was a favorite sound of Tom Bell.
Yeah.
They would sort of in the spot where traditionally you might have had a string line or even a background vocal line, they would use that sound, and it really set it apart.
Lyrically, is that song about, you know, repetitious, predictable behavior?
Yeah, it's a little bit of that. You're hanging in a relationship with somebody, and it's on again and it's off again, and you're engaged and then you're disengaged, and you're frustrated, but you still have feelings, and eventually you hit that wall and you kind of zoom out enough to get perspective and say, yeah, I don't think this is going to change.
And we get to hear the Canadian pronunciation of bean.
Yeah, you know, a couple of people mentioned that to me. You can't move to L.A. and not be taken to task for all your little Canadian vowel sounds.
We're looking for a boot, but we're not looking for bean.
I think I'm kind of cured of that one, but I do get the sorry.
Sorry.
Hey, sorry.
Yeah, but hey, my dad was from Michigan, and Michigan, it's a Michigan thing too. Sorry.
Is it? Sorry.
I'm sorry. Yeah. And he says roof instead of roof.
I don't know if I can relate to that one, but we definitely say mum instead of mom.
Well, I have a coworker from Michigan, and I notice when she says roof and different words, like, that's how my dad used to say it. It's a Michigan thing.
Right.
So yeah, B-E-E-N, bean.
That's how it's spelled.
But I was just saying B-E-E, as far as not too many E's, no, B-E-E-N, bean.
Should be bin, right?
But I have to say, you know, that song we were kind of talking about, Anyone, with the electric sitar. Of all the tracks on the album, interestingly, I think that's the chorus that's the most stuck in my head. I don't know if it's Lucy's voice or, you know, you wouldn't think it would be as memorable, but that's the one that's sort of been playing in my head a lot.
Well, what I was going for there is hypnotic, and I do find that if that happens to be the last track I was working on or the last track that I heard all or part of, it just keeps rolling around in my head. There's a cycle to that thing that just wants to keep going.
It worked on me. Do I have to quack like a duck now? What you got me to?
Right. I'll clap twice and you'll come too.
Yeah, well, it's interesting that you say you were going for that, because that's the effect it had on me.
Well, and also, that was one of, I think, two or three tracks that don't have horns on them.
Yeah.
Because we got to the end of, I think, me doing the lead vocal, and we had the basic tracks, and maybe that electric sitar overdub was on it, and I thought, this is pretty close to done now. I don't know if it needs five horns or six horns.
You know, like they say, death by improvement.
Right.
I've had a learning moment.
Yes, now it's in your vocabulary.
I'm probably going to use it every day now. I'll definitely use it in the studio. Well, next, we have the co-write with your brother and the return of our friend Drew Zing. Let's listen first and comment later.
Sure.
This is called, What Exactly Is It That You Do All Day?
Thank you. The memories jump cut inside of my head. I'm losing the thread. Guess I'll go back to bed.
And maybe watch some daytime TV.
I'm over the hump, but I heard what you said. You'd sooner be dead than to say I'd be wed.
At least to a doofus like me.
Now I'm living la vida, mochaccino. Even broke a bad habit or two. And I've been reading those self-help magazines. Though you took quite a few. So now how about you? Tell me, what exactly is it that you do all day? I got friends who tell me you've been doing okay. But what exactly is it that you're doing all day? If you're not missing me. The romaine, I poured the champagne, knowing you'd miss your train.
And maybe stay for the night.
Your boyfriend, the drummer, the fountains of Wayne, and doing cocaine, and your oldest friend, Jane.
Shit just wasn't right.
Then you moved into my Greenpoint apartment. Shelf and hung your art. Got a basket of fruit, then you bought me a suit. Tell me, what exactly is it that you do all day? I got friends who tell me you've been doing okay. But what exactly is it that you're doing all day? If you're not missing me. Among the ruins, the Stanley Cup for my Boston Bruins. I wanted nothing more than you when you impeached George Bush.
Tattoo.
I got friends who tell me you've been doing okay. But what exactly is it that you're doing all day? If you're not, what exactly is it that you do all day? I got friends who tell me you've been doing okay. But what exactly is it that you're doing all day? If you're not missing me.
One of my all-time favorite guitarists right there, and former guest of the show, so people go back and check that out. Well, I detect the presence of Jeff on that. You guys got to get a hockey reference in there like good Canadians. The Stanley Cup with Boston Bruins, an impeached George Bush tattoo, Fountains of Wayne, Living La Vida Mochaccino. How much of that was contributed by Jeff?
That's all Jeff. You know, when I write with Jeff, and this is only true in this one case, we absolutely keep our job descriptions separate. I become strictly the composer. He's strictly the lyricist.
Well, he's got a gift for words, for sure.
Oh, he makes me laugh.
Yeah, when I saw that stuff in there, I go, okay, well, he knows he's got... It kind of reminds me of those Christopher Guest movies where he has... Everything's improvised, and some people are the main characters and some are the smaller characters. They know they have less screen time, and they try and really make it count. So, so he's like, well, I got one track on Monkey House. I'll make sure people remember it.
Well, you know, the truth is a lot of what we write is in a more kind of theatrical, traditional, jazzy vein, so it doesn't necessarily lend itself to a Monkey House treatment. But that particular one did have more of a poppy chorus and a poppy form. And it actually started out much more British than that, and I added that kind of signature intro figure that keeps coming back to monkey it up a bit.
And how did you decide which solos to play on which thing? Did you just decide, well, this would be a good fit for this, and just...
Well, you know, the thing about Drew, he just slays me, man. You cannot scare him with chord changes.
No.
Like, he just knows his way around. He'll find the beautiful, logical, inevitable, slightly bluesy, inspiring thing to play around any chord change. You cannot scare him.
Well, there's three things. It's like, there's what he plays, the way he plays it, like the attitude of it, and the tone of his
guitar.
And
his sound, yeah.
Yeah, so those three things, like, he always stands out. When I had him on, we promoted his Steely Dan stuff, obviously his awesome solo album, and Boss Gags. And anytime he soloed, because we did some live stuff I played with Boss Gags and Steely Dan, the crowd, you know, like sometimes people will applaud after a solo and sometimes they won't at any gig.
Right.
Anytime he solos anything on any song, he gets applause.
He doesn't just get applause, he gets a roar from the crowd. Well,
Well, it's funny because I pointed out when he was here at the end of Home at Last, Donald Fagen goes, Drew Zing! And at the end of the Boss Gags one, Boss goes, Drew Zing on guitar, because they both kind of had to, because the audience was cheering more for him than anything else.
Right.
It was kind of obvious. But you also used a little motif there of the answer voice, like the inner monologue, sort of like telephone voice, making the little extra comment.
Yeah, well, that's something that would only happen, I think, when I was working with an outside lyricist. This song came to me as a finished lyric, and I wrote to it.
Oh.
So... When you're writing to someone else's rhythm, you hear it a certain way, and it's not always the metrical way that they heard it when they cooked it up. And so in this particular case, I ended up with these two little paragraphs with an extra line after each of them, and I thought, don't know what to do with it. Is it physically another singer answering me, or is it just kind of that weird radio inner monologue type voice? And I went with that.
Yeah, it was effective, and you only used it once, and you used it sparingly. But yeah, a funny lyrical concept. So he was Bernie Taupin on that one, and you were Elton John.
He was, yeah. Although, you know, Bernie and Elton, it always starts with a lyric sheet.
Right.
With Jeff and me, it's probably 50-50. Yeah. Sometimes I'll just send him a finished lead sheet with no title on it and just do a piano performance and let him go at it.
Yeah.
And it's fun both ways.
Yeah, I imagine it would be. Some dramatic drum fills by Mark Kelso in there.
Oh, yeah.
Speaking of Mark, I told him I was going to be interviewing you, and he had a comment he wanted to make. Because I know he worked on this album and the last album. I said, anything you want me to say to or about Don? And he wrote this. He said, I've been friends with Don for over 30 years now, and way back in the day, we shared our love of Gino Vannelli, Earth, Wind & Fire, Steely Dan, and Carvel ice cream commercials. While working at Canada's Wonderland, where we first met. We became friends instantly through music. So now to have seen Don rise in the business from his humble beginnings to all the great things he's been doing over the last few years, Monkey House, Bright Up Brothers, Emmy Award, author. I'm so happy for all his success. He's a super talented, hilarious person and a great musician. And I'm really happy that we're still good friends and we still get to work together, even though we live in different countries.
Isn't that lovely? Well, I mean... You know, I send all of that back to Mark. He's having incredible success, too, and he deserves every bit of it. And, He was one of those people that I instantly bonded over a very specific set of music with. You know, the people he mentioned, plus a few more. I mean, he's the one I remember who hipped me to the Yellow Jackets when they were just starting out. And a couple of other albums. There was that Klaus Ogerman album with Michael Brecker and Steve Gadd. That was around the same period.
Well, as we've all heard from the tracks, the dude can play. The dude can play well.
The dude can play. He actually had a stint with Gino Vannelli for a while.
Yeah, well, he's crushing it on this album. And that's one reason I reached out to him. You know, I was like going, hey, you know, want to talk a little bit about the experience. And he just focused on his friendship with you.
That's really nice. Yeah, I mean, he's absolutely, you know, the best drummer that I've worked with on any kind of regular basis ever in my life. Like, he just really doesn't have a weak spot. He plays every style authentically. He grooves like crazy. He can read down anything. If you point to him for a solo, it will be super memorable. But if you want him to just kind of whisper through something, he'll put his all into that too.
Yeah, and he has some great moments on this album in Death by Improvement and in the one we just heard. You know, speaking of your friends, let's talk a little bit about David Blaymeyers and Mark Jordan. In Headquarters, you did a track called Lebanon that was written with Mark Jordan. This one is called Maybe None of This Would Have Happened. Wrote it with Mark Jordan. David Blaymeyers returns with his backing vocals. Yeah, the concept on this one is sort of like you miss a train, then you meet someone. So you think, God, I was actually speaking with Olivia about this, how one thing happens and then you think because of that. You know, you meet a person, you think, I was meant to miss that train and meet this person. So it's random fate versus destiny and all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Was that Mark's concept or yours?
That was Mark's concept originally. You know, I work with Mark a lot. In fact, we're working on something right now that I'll be able to talk to you about later, but it's really super hush-hush right now. But it involves a long-gone jazz Hall of Famer. But Mark likes to start with some kind of finished full length or close to full length track because he just gets into the flow of it and he kind of thinks cinematically and stuff just comes to him. So that song started with a piano track that actually didn't have that little eighth note repetitive thing that you hear in the intro. And he came up with probably 2/3 to 3/4 of the lyric and a lot of the melody in one go. Then that intro got added, and then he batted the bridge back to me for lyrics, so I wrote that chunk of the lyric. And it probably banged back and forth maybe a half dozen times before we both signed off on it. But we had such good luck using David Blaymeyers on the backup vocals the last time on Lebanon that I just thought I would keep that little team together and use Dave again.
Yeah.
Because he... That's another guy who requires a minimum of direction. He just feels out the song and knows what's appropriate. And it's like you've got peak era David Pack or something doing your backup vocals.
Well, I saw him in concert when he was with Pat Metheny, and he was one of those two utility guys up there.
Right.
Where he and Pat would say, all right, now sing, now play some percussion. You're playing the accordion on this. You're playing the xylophone. Basically, any instrument the main band wasn't playing. He wouldn't ask him if he could play the instrument.
No, no.
He would just say, on this track.
Yes.
And it wouldn't be simple stuff. It was like, you know, it would be like this chart. Here's
the crazy ostinatos on the marimba. It's sort of, hey, Dave, good morning. You're a marimba player now.
Exactly.
But I mean, Dave was also, he was already a multi-instrumentalist. So he was a brass player and a guitar player and singer, obviously. So.
Well, Pat Metheny pushed him and got amazing things out of him.
Yeah.
Because I saw the show and I saw him having to stand up there and do all this. Now, you do a synth solo on this one, sort of a Mike Postish kind of keyboard sound instead of a horn or guitar. And what made you want to, because you haven't done as much soloing. We heard a little piano solo on Death by Improvement, but... You know, on some of the other stuff we've heard you do more, for example, Headquarters, you did more soloing yourself. So what was it about this track that made you want to take that approach?
Well, first of all, it's hard to insert yourself as a soloist when you're juggling, Drew Zing and Jay Graydon and Elliot Randall and all these people. So, I mean, I will gladly step aside for any of those kind of A-team people that agreed to participate. In this case, I have the feeling if I had cut that song 10 years earlier, it would have been a soprano sax solo. Something kind of snaky and mellow like that. But there's a certain segment of the audience that will turn off now when they hear soprano.
Oh, yeah.
because of, you know, certain specific practitioners of that instrument.
We know who you're talking about.
Whose surname might just be a capital letter.
You're talking about Lenny T, right?
Right. I tried a piano solo and I tried a Rhodes solo on this tune too. And I eventually realized, I sort of went back to what I was originally hearing, which was that more singy, linear type of thing. And I thought, it's nice to have one synth solo on each record. I mean, I am a keyboard player after all.
Yeah, my feeling is, in my mind, I imagine that you got sort of the end and go, you know, I haven't really done a solo. I should probably do at least one. And I can also imagine you thinking, I've got like all these great players. Sorry, Elliot. Sorry, Jay. You can't play on my album. I need to do a little.
Yeah, I need my space.
Exactly. So, well, yeah, well, I'm not playing every track, so, because the police will get me, as you can hear, if I try and play every track, the internet police are on to me. I want to talk about a co-write you did with a new collaborator, at least in terms of, but this person was on Monkey House as a vocalist, and she doesn't appear to be credited as a vocalist, but as a co-writer. The song is The Art of Starting Over, and Julie's the co-writer. So did she contribute musically, lyrically, both?
Well, that that song, The Art of Starting Over, actually is by far the oldest song on this album. Julie and I had written that, I don't even know how many years ago, but I'm going to say at least 10.
Okay.
And it had been shortlisted for a couple of her records. I definitely had a version of it that was on the shortlist for Headquarters. And finally, I sort of moved some of the puzzle pieces around and tacked a different kind of intro and tag on it this time and went, okay, now it's ready for the world.
So it's been around a while.
It has. And it's not that I didn't want her singing on this record, but she happened to be having a baby that week.
No excuse. No sympathy.
Right.
Well, it's not like you lost a step with Lucy. So how does a Canadian living in California end up with the Prague Philharmonic Orchestra on a track?
Well, that's an interesting story. You know, recording string sections is so expensive that increasingly people go to the Czech Republic or Russia or Bulgaria or other places to do it, because they're wonderful, classically trained pros over there, but they're not bound by the same union restrictions and all that. So I'm sure they make a good buck, but it's not quite as crazy financially. Part of the advantage of being on a label like Alma is that they have a big roster of artists and everybody's doing interesting stuff. And it just so happened that Ian Thomas, brother of Dave Thomas from SCTV, was doing a kind of career summing album where he's redoing a lot of his hits and stuff he's written for other people with a full symphony. And Peter, who runs Alma, was producing that record, and they were doing all the strings over in Prague. And he got to me probably with about 48 hours to spare and said, if you can cook up a string chart for one of the tunes on the Monkey House record, I think I can piggyback that into nice. This other session. And of course I jumped at that, and it seemed like The Art of Starting Over, which is by far the moodiest, kind of slowest tune on the record, was the one to use that.
Well, and conceptually, you're leaving Toronto, you're going to LA, you're starting over. So it fits that sort of idea.
Yeah, I mean, thematically it fits, and that's one of the reasons it's at the end.
Mm-hmm.
The other reason it's at the end, it just has such a nice long fade, and it's just kind of the record going off into the sunset and saying goodbye.
Well, how did she feel when she heard it? Well, before you answer that question, you know, when I heard the strings, I thought, wow, Kurzweil has really outdone themselves with their new string patch.
Right. If only you could buy that. If only that were a plug-in.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, what did she think when she heard the finished product?
Well, she actually hasn't heard the mix that we're hearing today. I mean, I know she loves the song because we've both put a lot of faith in it over the years and considered recording it.
Yeah, not just the strings, there's nice horn parts on it as well. And trumpet solo, not Michael Linhart, William
Sperandi, yeah.
William Sperandi.
Who I've been using a lot in recent years, and he's an incredible soloist as well. Toronto guy, studied with Ellis Marsalis in New Orleans, and he's a great composer, keyboard player, a million other things himself. But the interesting thing about the horn versus string chart on The Art of Starting Over was I had written the horn chart to be kind of self-sufficient and fill all the holes. And then with a couple days' notice, I get this opportunity to write a string chart too. But I already liked what we had recorded horn-wise, and so now I've got kind of the natural spaces and pauses in the song that have been three-quarters filled with horn activity. Now I'm dodging the strings in and out of all those.
You had 48 hours in how many piece orchestra?
Well, it was strings only. They were recording a full orchestra over there, but we didn't use the winds. We just used the string section. I'm going to say it was probably a 40-piece string section.
So I like the way you use the word opportunity. I had this opportunity to stress myself out for 48 hours.
Oh, well, I mean, I love arranging. You know, there are times that's my favorite part of the whole process.
I just mean the deadline aspect of it. Hey, Don, I got an orchestra sitting here waiting for you to tell them what to play.
Right.
You got, let's see, today's Monday. By Wednesday, that's what I meant.
That's right. You're not going to go to the bathroom between now and then.
Right.
Have fun.
Yeah, but as you said, you know, arranging, you mentioned in the Brass Transit you did arrangements without any instruments, just out of your brain, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
My favorite chart on that Brass Transit album I wrote in the Starbucks in New York City, just sat there for the afternoon.
Was that the Todd Rundgren?
Yeah, that was the Todd Rundgren one, yeah, with this sort of double time at the end. I love, you know, and there are definitely some horn charts on this Monkey House record that were written on airplanes, too, so.
Yeah. Well, that's an ability I do not possess.
It's a little magic trick that I do.
That's right. Well, maybe you already said you're a hypnotist. Maybe that track Anyone can hypnotize me into becoming a string arranger. We've spoken about it quite a bit. Let's listen to this collaboration with Julie Crochetière. Is that how she says it?
Excellent. Bien dit.
Let's listen to this, The Art of Starting Over.
Again, make me care. just another chance. Of the now, you wonder how you live so long on the later. The art of starting over takes an long time to learn. The art of starting over is believing in just a just a little further.